Good evening.
Welcome to Straight Talk, featuring Greg Middleton. We continue with our series on the Pearls of Wisdom. Our topic today is titled Call of Duty. Here is Greg.
Hi, Alexandra. How goes it in cyberspace?
All is well, Greg.
Good to hear and peace be with you.
Thank you.
My talk today is The Call of Duty. To whom are we held accountable? To whom are we responsible? Who say you? It depends upon who you belong to. Do you know who you belong to? For I am enslaved to no one save God. My soul is free. Not even my life belongs to me because I have been purchased at a price. Blood was shed so that I can live eternally with the one who saved me from myself and from this world of woe. I know to whom I belong. It was with my free will that I gave my heart and soul over to my Lord and Master, Adonai. Now, is this just the rantlings of a sinner? How many of you know your destiny? Interestingly, some will claim that my utterances have the ring of blasphemy. We cannot speak for God, nor do we know what God thinks, some would say. Well, I would refute such a claim. We know exactly what God wants and what He thinks, even though our thoughts are not His thoughts. This is because God has made Himself known to mankind. He let us know what is required of us as well as how to achieve what is required. Now, if you don't know this, turn around and look at the mirror at yourself and ask, why don't I know this? This is not new. Countless souls have discovered this secret and could boast about their findings. They would love to share with you, should you ask. They asked of the Lord, and He revealed Himself to them. My people don't have because they don't ask, says the Lord. This series regarding the pearls of wisdom has been enlightening. I have spoken plainly what I have been shown. This is not something new. I am by no means unique to this discovery. The Lord God has been present on the earth since the beginning with Adam and Eve. He has been here throughout the lives of countless souls that made earth their home for the years that the Lord provided for them. God makes Himself known to those who diligently seek Him. Once your heart is ready to receive Him, then the floodgates are opened. The living waters flow from within, not from the outside. When you were born, God blew His Spirit into your carnal body that gave you life and being. Now, as you become ready, the Spirit is made alive from within. The saints have discovered this and want to share it with those who have not yet discovered the truth. You shall know the truth, and it shall set you free. Now, how many ways can this same story be told? How many people have repeated something similar about God? Could they all be that wrong? Is this a trick that has been played on mankind for all these years? If so, who could pull off such a long-lasting bamboozlement for that long? If you truly believe that mankind has been tricked since the beginning of time, then you must believe that there are powers that exist in the natural world that are godlike in nature. Therefore, if you believe there is an overshadowing negative power that wants to keep us blinded and in bondage, why can't you believe that there is a more superior power that sits above the negative one? If you believe in the power of the evil one, then is it that hard for you to conceptualize the power of good and of God? Now, I talk to you plainly in your verbiage so you might digest the question and seek your heart for answers. For those of you who have found the keys to the kingdom, it was not you who discovered God, but God who opened your eyes to His truth. Again, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Now that you are made aware of such truth, it is your duty to tell others. Finding God may be difficult for some of you, as stated in the scripture, when it says the road to the kingdom of heaven is narrow and only a few will find it. This does not mean that it is impossible to find, but only those who are made worthy of finding it will receive what is shown. God knows the heart because He lives there. He cannot be deceived by your mind, as can you. Therefore, should anyone want to know God, and it comes from a sincere heart, the gates are open unto those who diligently seek Him. God cannot be hidden from Himself. God lives in His people, so all He must do is reveal Himself to Himself. Ironically, some people attempt to fool God, not knowing that they are only fooling their mind, not God. God can't be fooled nor mocked by those whom He made. So let's bring this down to where the rubber meets the road. Either you are for or against God. Unfortunately, there's no third option in reference to the disposition of your immortal soul. That being the case, then go back to the questions I asked you earlier. To whom are you held accountable? To whom are you responsible? Who say you? Do you know who you belong to? Now, the answer to each of these questions shouldn't be a mystery. If you have not yet inquired of yourself, and if you do not seek, you cannot find. God wants those who diligently seek Him. He comes to their aid and take them from what is impossible with man to what is possible with God. You, by your mortal might, cannot do this. God does not allow the ungodly the power to enter His kingdom by their might. It must be done through and by Him. Therefore, you have a simple choice to make. Do you want what is God's, or do you wish to keep everything close to the chest? If you think you can do this without God, that would be your free will choice. Now let's discuss this thing called duty. If God has blessed you with the knowledge of Him, then you have a duty to spread it to others. God does not wish to be kept under a blanket, but instead let His light so shine that all are illuminated. If God wants to be revealed, then it becomes our duty to make it so from mortal to mortal. God does not force Himself on mankind. So if mankind is willing to listen to others that can see and touch, they become God's ambassadors. As ambassadors, it is our duty to spread what God has shown us to others who are not yet there. We are therefore duty-bound. As a child of God, this is not a burden but a privilege and an honor. How say you? Far be it from me to shame anyone or to make anyone feel inferior in any way. That would not be godly, nor would it accomplish the duty of which we are bound in chains. There is a story in the scripture about Christ leaving 99 sheep under the dome of God's protection while he went out to find the one that was lost. Those who are covered by God are protected by God. However, the one who got lost is vulnerable to all the dark powers from the spiritual kingdom. We are like the shepherd's sheep. Some of us are the ones who got lost. If you belong to the Lord, you will not be forsaken. Look up into the heavens from which comes your help, Jehovah Rahim. He is your shepherd. God's people are comforted by God. As for you Bible students, read the entire 40th chapter of the book of Isaiah. Let the word of God speak directly into your heart. For those of you who see duty as burdensome, it's because you do not know to whom much is given, much is expected in return. If God has given you his blessings, he expects you to spread it to others. Now, if that feels like a burden, then why would you expect to be blessed if you are not willing to bless others? Perhaps when you deal with mankind, you might feel such a burden. But if you have God's Spirit in your heart, it is a pure delight to assist others. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. You should be willing to be the first in line to give, not even respecting anything in return.
This is from the heart. Like sometimes when I see people doing charities, I could tell they're just doing it for the moment. Like for example, whenever it's a hurricane relief thingy, people who you never see do anything, all of a sudden they just pop up and they're tweeting about it. Like I tell people all the time, I do a lot of stuff seen and unseen. Like it doesn't matter to me if you know that I just fed 10,000 homeless. That I'm doing this because this was what I was taught. I'm doing it because to walk in there and see a family put a smile on their face for a day, that's just awesome to me.
Whether it be visiting an ill child in the hospital, donating money or something else, what's been the singular, most personally satisfying thing you've done?
Well, they all have been satisfying. One time a grandmother had a kid that couldn't walk. I bought her a van. And see, like these are stories that you'll never hear. I bought her a van. Just the other day, I get an email, a little beautiful, and I'll give you her mother's number so you can talk to her. A little beautiful girl that has cancer, A. Marie. So the mom hits me an email. I don't know if this is your email, but my daughter, she calls you Bubby. She would like to see you. I'm in L.A. So I hit her back. I'll be in L.A. I'm going to come see you. This isn't Shaq. I'm like, all right, whatever you say. So I go see her, and she wasn't doing well before I went to go see her. So now that I went to see her, her spirits are up, she's happy. I told her to hang in there. And, you know, just seeing the kid smile, just seeing the kid smile, it's fulfilling to me, you know, to know that a former high-level juvenile delinquent, who all the experts said was going to be in the Army like his father, who all the people said he was going to be a bum, all the people said he wasn't going to do anything, is now the guy that's making kids all around the world smile. That's my thing. I just want to make you smile.
Our Lord would say, Don't even let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. Let your good deeds be done unto the Lord, from which all his blessings come forth. Give ye unto God, and he rewards you for what you do unto him. Christ said, what you do unto others, likewise you do unto him. And this would include both the good and the bad. The only catch in the reverse is that it will be rewarded by the King of Kings rather than mere earthly treasures. Store your treasures in heaven, where you will spend eternity, not on earth, where they will be subject to rot and decay.
Reach out and touch somebody's hand. Make this world a better place if you can. Reach out and touch somebody's hand. Make this world a better place if you can.
Just try.
Take a little time.
In this series on the pearls of wisdom, you have been encouraged to give God a try. A call of duty is not for those who feel burdened, but for those who feel they have been blessed and want to spread the good news about God. For those who have tasted the Lord and know he is good, it is an honor rather than anything burdensome. It's a privilege to serve God and to have been selected by him to do so. Perhaps you are not there yet in this stage of your life. Understandably so. Many of us have walked in the same shoes you now walk. We know what we had to go through to change our attitudes from a frown to a smile, and then to tears of joy. We pray for those on the outside to only touch the hem of his garment, so their eyes can be opened to understanding of his ways and his word. We pray that God shower his spirit on the world so they would receive new hearts, one that know him. To know God is only to love him. However, with that stated, not everyone is there yet. Remember, you were once like them. So here's my final verdict. A call of duty to the saints is one that is eagerly accepted. It is not a burden, but instead an honor and a privilege. As ambassadors of our Lord, it is our duty to do for others what was done for us. We did not save ourselves. We had lots of help along the way. Now you, in return, must become the help for others in need. What has been done for you must be done for others who are in need. Christ said that he would not lose even one soul that the Father has assigned to him. We are his ambassadors here on earth to facilitate that very mission. To Almighty God be the glory. Selah.
It's so beautiful.